Okay, welcome to the 10th meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. Apologies have been received from Pam Duncan-Glancy and Paul O'Kane is attending as substitute member. Welcome, Paul. Agenda item 1 is to agree whether to take items 5 and 6 in private, which is consideration of today's evidence and consideration of our approach to our stage 1 scrutiny of the Minor Strike Pardon Scotland Bill. Are we all agreed? That is agreed, thank you. Our next agenda item is consideration of an affirmative instrument, which is the Draft Independent Reviewer Modifications of Functions Scotland Regulations 2021. And I welcome to this morning's meeting Claire Hockey, MSP Minister for Children and Young People, Angela Leonard, Policy Officer Disclosure Scotland, and Barry McCaffrey, Solicitor, Legal Director in the Scottish Government. You're all very welcome. And I refer members to paper 1. And invite the Minister to speak to the regulations.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for inviting me to say a few words on the draft regulations. These amendments are technical and are necessary to ensure that the Age of Criminal Responsibility Scotland Act 2019 can be applied as intended. I'll now refer to this as the 2019 Act. The 2019 Act raised the age of criminal responsibility in Scotland from 8 to 12. The Act established the role of the independent reviewer who oversees the disclosure of convictions and other relevant information related to when a person was under the age of 12. The purpose of these regulations is to amend the 2019 Act. The regulations are in consequence of the Age of Criminal Responsibility Scotland Act 2019, Consequential Provisions and Modifications Order 2021. That order, which is currently being considered by the Westminster Parliament, makes provision in relation to the independent reviewer, which applies in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. In particular, the order places a requirement on specified persons in those jurisdictions, such as, for example, chief police officers, to refer and provide information relating to an individual's pre-12 behaviour to the independent reviewer. These regulations therefore modify, in light of that order, the relevant functions of the independent reviewer in the 2019 Act. This is to require the independent reviewer to review that information, invite representations, notify the outcome of the review, and where appropriate, advise on the right to appeal that decision. The changes support the Scottish Government's decision to raise the age of criminal responsibility from 8 to 12. By ensuring that the independent reviewer can review relevant information received from specified persons in other parts of the UK as well as Scotland. Committee members will wish to note that these regulations do not take forward any new policy. They are required to fully implement the 2019 Act, and I would be happy to take any questions on the regulations.
Thank you very much. Do any members have any questions or comments on the regulations? Okay, and that case, we'll move to agenda item 3, which is consideration of the motion for approval, and invite the Minister to move the motion.
I move that the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee recommends the Independent Reviewer Modification of Functions Scotland Regulations 2021 be approved.
Okay, any final comments from any members? In that case, are we all agreed? Okay, that is agreed, and we'll therefore the clerks will write a note and report on our decision, and the motion is agreed as moved. Okay, that completes consideration of the affirmative instrument, and I thank the Minister and officials for attending. Thank you. Now, suspend briefly. OK, the next item on the agenda is to take evidence from our civil justice stakeholders on remote hearings and digital justice. And I welcome to the meeting Kay McCorkadale, Executive Director, Judicial Office, Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, Ruth Crawford QC, Treasurer of the Faculty of Advocates, Ian Nicol, Convener of the Civil Justice Committee in the Law Society of Scotland, Karen Wiley, Vice Chair, Family Law Association of Scotland, and Professor Richard Susskind, OBE, Technology Advisor to the Lord Chief Justice of England and Wales, who is joining us remotely. You're all very welcome to today's session. And I refer members to papers 2 and 3. Now I invite each of our witnesses to make short opening statements, starting with Kay, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Committee, for asking me to be part of this roundtable event. I'd like to make a short opening statement on behalf of the Scottish Courts Tribunal Service. So the Scottish Courts Tribunal Service Digital Strategy, which was published in 2018, set out a 5-year ambition to move towards an increasingly digital service. Now, significant progress has been made on that front, largely out of necessity. It is fair to say that the pace of change has increased to an unprecedented level over the past year and a half. We could not have anticipated the speed with which we would need to develop an increasingly digital service and conduct business remotely. Throughout the pandemic, we have supported all essential civil business by focusing our efforts on managing as much business as possible remotely, whether that be by written submissions, teleconference or virtual hearings. Now, throughout this period of rapid change, we worked collaboratively with the legal profession, the judiciary and our staff. We shared a common goal of getting the business done. Our use of the WebEx platform as a solid foundation for remote operations has ensured that SCTS has been able to support the conduct of civil business electronically. And as a consequence, business across the civil courts has been able to proceed. There are no backlogs. Remote management of business and hearings remains the norm at this point in time. And as we move through the response to COVID-19 and into recovery, we will continue to review how civil business can best be conducted. We will work with our justice partners, including the Scottish Government, to ensure that the innovations that have been essential in enabling civil business to continue are retained. However, the Scottish Civil Justice Council is the body tasked with modernising the civil justice system in Scotland, and it is ultimately the Council's decision to decide how civil court proceedings should proceed. Our ambition for the SCTS is for our services, in whichever way they are provided, to be accessible, transparent and above all fear. And for the lessons that we have learned over the past 20 months to be put to the best possible use, promoting more sustainable and efficient options as we seek to further improve access to justice. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I ask Ruth?
Thank you and good morning, Convener and members of this committee. And like Kay, I would thank you for inviting me to give evidence to this morning's session on behalf of the Faculty of Advocates. It seems to us that there are two core principles when considering the benefits and advantages of digital justice as it's described in your agenda. And both, of course, centre on that word justice. The two core principles underline the crucial importance of our justice system, which is itself an integral part of our democratic system. The first core principle is that of open justice. The public, and indeed the media, must be able to effectively access what goes on in our courts. At present, perhaps for understandable reasons due to concerns that those accessing the courts remotely may abuse their access, but at present, access to video hearings is limited. And the court has concerns going forward about how to deal with access by the public to our courts if we are going to continue with remote hearings. That principle of open justice has been part of our law since 1693, enacted in the Court of Session Act of that year. The courts have been open to all since 1693, save in specific special cases. And that principle of open justice has been consistently recognised throughout the courts both in England and Wales, as well as Scotland, and indeed in every jurisdiction of which we are aware, save for those of autocratic states. That reflects the principle that justice must not only be done, but must be seen to be done. The second core principle, which I suggest should be at the root of your inquiries, is that of the constitutional right of access to the courts. And in that regard, I wonder if I could quote the words of Lord Reed in a case Unison against Lord Chancellor in 2017 in the Supreme Court. And his lordship said this: "The constitutional right of access to the courts is inherent in the rule of law. The importance of the rule of law is not always understood," indicating a lack of understanding. And that lack of understanding includes the assumption that the administration of justice is merely a public service, like any other, and that courts and tribunals are the provider of services to, quote, users who appear before them, and that the provision of those services is of value only to the users themselves and those who are remunerated for their participation in the proceedings. And it is important, in my opinion, to bear in mind that this is a constitutional right of crucial importance, and that justice is not simply a service, as opposed to all the other many important services which this Parliament has to address and deal with. And if there are to be any inroads to the right of access to justice, it respectfully seems to me that primary legislation would be required. That importance of the right of access to justice goes to the root of the rule of law in a democratic society. So the discussion, it seems to me, of the benefits and disadvantages of digital technology in the courts has to have those two core principles at the forefront. And those two core principles should not be sacrificed or diminished in any way. But I look forward to discussing the other benefits and disadvantages in the course of this morning session. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Ian.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Committee. The Law Society of Scotland welcomes the opportunity to assist the Committee with its consideration of the use of remote hearings in the civil justice sector. As the Committee will be aware, the Society has a statutory duty under the Solicitors Scotland Act 1980 to promote the interests of the solicitors' profession and its 12,000-plus members, as well as the interests of the public in relation to that profession. And everything I say here today is intended to reflect that dual purpose. We have endeavoured over the period of the pandemic to understand what is working well and what is not working so well in relation to the necessary changes that were thrust upon all stakeholders in the civil courts. And I hope that the lessons that we've learned can be of assistance to the committee deliberations. Thank you.
Thank you. And Karen.
Good morning, and thank you for the invitation to give evidence today on behalf of the Family Law Association. The Family Law Association has a membership of family lawyers across Scotland, and we are committed to the constructive resolution of family law disputes. Given that I represent the Family Law Association, the focus of anything I have to say will be family law cases. I think there's little doubt that the pandemic has given us many opportunities to modernise how we deal with family cases and civil cases in our courts. Where family cases are concerned, these deal with a large range of issues of great importance to the lives of everyday people, such as divorce, the separation of cohabiting couples, the care arrangements for children, public law, child law cases such as permanence orders where parental responsibilities and rights may be removed from a biological parent and authority may be given for that child to be adopted. There are also cases such as children's hearings. Some of these cases will involve parties who are some of society's most vulnerable people, individuals who may not have the financial resources to obtain the best technology, software, broadband connection to participate, and individuals who also require support to participate and individuals who should not be at the receiving end, for example, of a decision about children and be sitting perhaps on their own at the end of a telephone or watching a screen in their home. There is no doubt that we have had many opportunities to look at how we do things, and for the Family Law Association, we don't want to go back to the past and how we've done things previously. But there is concern amongst our members that we don't want to rush into a new system that has come in hastily and quite understandably as the result of a pandemic. But we want to look at, as Ian has said, what is working well and what is not working well. My understanding is that for family cases, the proposed default in the draft rules at the moment is that all family hearings will be in person, other than certain exceptions, and that is welcomed by our members. Thank you.
Thank you. And Richard.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry I can't be with you in person, but I'm very appreciative of the opportunity to say a few words. Although I'm billed as the technology advisor to the Lord Chief Justice of England and Wales, I'm not speaking on his behalf today. I speak as someone who's spent the last 40 years thinking about how we might use technology to improve access to justice. A couple of opening thoughts. One, a fundamental distinction that I hope might help our discussion between what I call automation and innovation, two ways you can use technology. The first 60 years of court technology and legal technology have been about automation, essentially using technology to streamline and optimize and render more efficient our current processes. And that's what most people think of when they think of technology. You take some inefficient process and you apply technology to it. But there's another use of technology that you see in other sectors, which I call innovation, which is using technology to allow you to do things that previously weren't possible. And so we have to be alive, I think, to this distinction. This is not simply about computerizing how we work today. I would hope it's about thinking, oh, we might use the power of technology, for example, to extend the reach of our court system to people who today otherwise do not have access. COVID, of course, changed the discussion about the future of courts. I helped found a website called Remote Courts Worldwide, www.remotecourts.org, where we track progress of countries across the world who've moved from physical courts to one form or another of remote court. We now have 168 different jurisdictions represented on that service, which give a strong sense of just the extent to which, in a very short period of time, we've seen court systems change. We've learned a number of lessons, I think. The reality is, although lawyers and judges are often criticized for being quite conservative, the truth was, when the platform was burning, lawyers and judges proved to be remarkably adaptable and flexible. But one thing that I found slightly unhelpful, and I put this before you because I find in these discussions this unhelpful element often creeps in, is a slightly polarizing effect, say in relation to video hearings, which has been the dominant mechanism used during COVID. What I'm finding is that lawyers and judges either belong to the camp who are saying, quite melodramatically, we should never go back, our future is transformed, on the one hand, and others who are hankering and hunkering. I say they're hankering after our old ways of working and hunkering down until the viral storm passes. And I don't think we need to take up one position or another. I think, as has already been hinted, we should be looking at the experience of COVID courts and thinking what works well that we might industrialize and what doesn't work well when we need to go back to physical courts or other alternatives. A bigger point, though, is that I don't believe video hearings are the end game in the future of courts. Dropping a court hearing into Zoom is not a full transformation of the court model. It's still the same people, the same rules, the same problems and difficulties that many people identify with the civil court system. And so I agree wholeheartedly that we have to look at video hearings as an important first step. But I chaired, for example, the Civil Justice Council in England, our group on online dispute resolution, where we found different methods. I can talk about these shortly. The asynchronous hearing, which isn't actually a hearing at all. There are different methods open to us. So we're at the foothills. That's my main message. Don't think it's either a physical hearing or a video hearing. And as for justice, absolutely correct, as the first witness observed. But I should say, in closing, that people use the concept of justice both in support of and in opposition to the developments. Some say justice will be better served because we can offer far greater access, and others say, well, if you don't have a physical hearing, you're not having a fair process. The problem we face, I believe, is that civil process in most jurisdictions too costly, too combative, it's unintelligible unless you're a lawyer, takes too long. And so I think we should be open to new ways of working. And that's why I've been asking the question since 1990s. In conclusion, is court of service a place? Do we really need physically to assemble together on all occasions to solve our legal differences? Or might it be more appropriate and proportionate sometimes to convene online in a variety of ways? Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, everyone. So the proposal now is that we then have a discussion. Our committee members have some areas that they want to prod and probe, but obviously the benefit of these roundtables is that when the panel members bounce off each other to have that discussion, and to some extent we might find ourselves sitting listening to that discussion that's ongoing, and that will help us in our further deliberations around the issue of remote hearings. Obviously, we've all heard what everyone said. Anybody wanting to come in with an initial kind of comment on some of the points? Karen?
Can I come in? Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask Carden a question. You mentioned that in most cases it will be in person unless there are certain circumstances. So it's kind of a two-part question. It's just to ask, you know, what circumstances would they be? And in regards to particularly family law, where domestic abuse may be a factor, would remote be preferable for some? And have you had feedback on that?
At the moment, to answer the first part of your question, as I understand it, the draft rules are that in the Court of Session, it will be pre-proof hearings and case management hearings, so procedural hearings where parties are not present. Similarly, in the Sheriff Court, it's options hearings, procedural hearings, pre-proof hearings. Again, with the exception of options hearing, which at the moment clients are supposed to attend. Although I think there's some discussion amongst our members about whether that's really necessary. But at the moment, the court rules require that clients attend an options hearing. But all of these are procedural hearings at which our clients ordinarily wouldn't be present. And these hearings are not dealing with evidence. They're not dealing with opposed motions where there is some debate about a particular issue that the sheriff or the judge in the Court of Session requires to decide on, and our members support that is the way forward. And I think in terms of what is working well at the moment, it's the procedural hearings, it's these hearings that tend to work well ordinarily, with the exception of difficulty perhaps with broadband connection and so on aside. Where domestic abuse is concerned, I can see that for some clients, being online may be easier for them to be. I can think of an example that was given to me by a colleague where there was a child welfare hearing, which is a hearing in which they would discuss the care arrangements for children or some issue around the children of a relationship. And there were allegations of domestic abuse in that particular case. And it was the wife in that situation, and she chose to put her camera off, and that was allowed. And she found that easier not to be observed while the matter was ongoing. So I can see that there can be, in certain circumstances, benefits. There is a flexibility in, you know, having the camera on or off. So there are some benefits with that. But I think for many parents, they may wish to be present when these matters are being discussed. I think very often when the parties can speak, for example, in a child welfare hearing, and I think for any decision maker, listening to the matters that are being discussed and debated at a child welfare hearing, the behaviour of the parties can, I think, influence a decision, how they perhaps address a sheriff when asked a question, how they respond, how they behave. And we talk about that in the evidential hearings and proofs that the decision maker will be weighing up the credibility and the reliability of witnesses. And it's my belief that the sheriffs and the decision makers do that in child welfare hearings also. So there can be benefits to being present. It can perhaps assist the decision maker for parties to be present. And it may be that this is one of the things where the parties should be able to ask for a particular hearing where it suits their circumstances. But I do think that many parents want to be present and it would be difficult for them. At the moment, for example, I can think of there are child welfare hearings in some courts where it's conducted by telephone. I don't think a telephone hearing is appropriate for a child welfare hearing. At the very least, we should be using WebEx for that. There are all sorts of practical difficulties where telephone hearings are concerned. But I think for many parents, they want to be present. They want to be involved in a greater way in matters of importance concerning their children.
OK, thanks. Just to say, if folk can just indicate if they want to come in, and Richard has indicated, and then Kay.
Thank you very much. A couple of observations. One of the great unanswered questions across the world is what kinds of cases are suitable for remote hearings. I use that as a generic term for non-physical hearings. And what kinds of cases, frankly, do we generally agree should be settled in the traditional way? And we're feeling our way there. It's very early days. The thought I just wanted to plant was, what kind of evidence do we require to accept that one form of alternative is better than another? I hope you'll agree that our thinking about the future of the court system should be evidence-based. Now, I have my own instincts and intuitions about the kinds of cases that are well suited to remote hearings and the kinds that would be better dealt with in a physical courtroom. But just as we're seeing in medicine, where they undertake, for example, randomized control trials and the peer review studies of developments, I think we need to have the same rigor in law. All of you in the room today will have strong feelings and instincts, and we'll be hearing anecdotes from judges and experienced lawyers about what works and what doesn't work. And they're all very helpful, but isn't it time that we take a step back and say, if we are going to be evidence-based in the future of our court system, what kinds of evidence do we need to have that allow us to move from the traditional system to new ways of working? Remembering also, of course, that the current system we have is not the result of an evidence-based choice, just where we are today. But I do think we need to start thinking in a more evidence-based way. And I call here for us to be gathering far more data about our experiences of using courts, remote courts today, experiences from judges, from practitioners, but perhaps above all else, from court users.
OK, thank you. Maggie, and then Kay, then Ian.
Thanks very much, Joe, and good morning to everybody. Thank you for joining us this morning. Picking up and following on from both Karen's points on the sort of way in which we think about location, and I'm mindful of what Richard said about innovation and needing to think beyond what we have rather than just replacing what we have with, you know, on with a digital or online system, but thinking beyond that. I'm also mindful of what Ruth said around that second principle, the constitutional right of access to the courts. And I'd be interested to hear comments and thoughts about if we're thinking about the system that we have now or pre-pandemic, I suppose, which is not the product of maybe any strategic decision-making based on evidence, as Richard has outlined. And we're thinking of what we've learned over the last 18 months with the use of digital, the use of online, the use of telephone, the use of alternative mechanisms of being in contact. The one thing I think we also need to think about is where something happens. And obviously we have the physical place that is the courts. We have the physical places that may be people's homes or safe places if they're supported by organisations to give evidence, or that kind of thing. But is there something in what is very codified in the Bahnhofshus or the Bahnhofshus principle for children who are witnesses or people, young people who have been the victims of crime. Is there something that we can learn from that takes that maybe still allows for that very, very clear principle, Ruth, that you were talking about, but takes away from the some of the tensions and the conflict that is, I think, inevitable in a court setting, whether that is online or in person, in a physical courtroom. So I'd be interested. I know other people want to come in on Karen's points about family courts as well, but if you could wrap that up.
Kay, then Ian.
I'd like to address a few of the matters that have been raised. Firstly, I think it might help to put in context. Karen talked about draft rules, etc. Just so you're all aware, I talked previously about the Scottish Civil Justice Council, and that's a body that is tasked with modernising civil justice. Now, they've just had a public consultation on the mode of attendance at court hearings, and attached to that consultation was a draft set of rules, and everybody was asked to respond. And that consultation closed on the 15th of November, and we're fortunate enough to say that we've had 82 responses. And all the non-confidential ones are already on the Scottish Civil Justice Council's website if you want to have a chance to look at them. And the whole point of that consultation was to air these issues. And as Richard says, we don't want there are polarised views in there. But the role of the council now is to go through all these responses and analyse them. The council actually met yesterday and they had a high-level summary of those responses, but now the secretariats are tasked with analysing them all, and there will be a full analysis provided to the next council's meeting in January. And as a result of that, the intention is that there will be court rules taking into account all these comments, which will be promulgated by the court and then placed in the Parliament. So that's the first point I wanted to say, just to put in context what these draft rules are. And another point from Karen, yes, we absolutely do already have vulnerable witness suites where people who do not want to give evidence in court can give their evidence remotely. Perfect examples in domestic abuse cases, and we will continue to expand that facility. Evidence base, again, absolutely agree with Richard. We so need this, and having looked at the responses to the draft consultation, there are polarised views, and most of them are based on anecdotal evidence. You know, you speak to every solicitor, every judge, they've all got their own views, their own experiences. We need a firm evidence base if we're going to be taking this forward on a permanent basis. Now, I do know that the Scottish Government are to proceed with a remote hearing evaluation project. It's currently going out to tender. The Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service have fed into that, and we're actually partly funding it because we acknowledge that we need that firm evidence base to enable matters to be put on a firm footing for the future. Barn House principle, Maggie commented, absolutely, that's something that the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service is absolutely very keen on implementing. I think one of the committees has heard evidence on this already, and Lady Dorian's review of sexual offences really touched on that, and I understand that the Scottish Government is going to be taking that forward, and Scottish Court Service are 100% in favour of that for children who are vulnerable, who might be victims of sexual abuse, and definitely taking them out of the court system, pre-recording their evidence as quickly as possible is definitely the way forward. So that's all I'd like to add at this stage.
We'll take Alexander and then go to Ian. Yeah.
Thank you, Convener. I think, you know, the legal system itself needs to be commended for how quickly it adapted to the whole of this process, because it was virtually overnight that things changed for all of us. But as an organisation and as an industry, you seem to have all managed to coordinate extremely well. And I think Richard's comments about evidence and data are very important as we progress. And you've already identified that there are areas that you're looking at. The area I'd like to maybe just touch on is the sort of digitally excluded, because they have a huge issue to try and tap into the system that you've created. And you've talked about the pioneering issues about WebEx, etc. And we've seen some of that structure as the committee already in previous things. And I think that is to be commended. But also, there is the whole idea of resource and funding as to how it's managed and how you, as an industry, create and support all of that so that you can include as many as humanly possible. And the reviews that will happen will identify some areas that you may be meant to capture, but there are areas also that are going to be barriers, potentially, for you to try and communicate your role and your responsibility to the general public. And I think that that needs to be examined in some way as to how you square that circle, because there will be problems that you will face as we progress. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Ian.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to associate myself with Professor Susskind's comments about the need for data. We at the Law Society have been calling for the Scottish courts to introduce a pilot scheme because, as things stand, the civil courts are by and large not open. With a few exceptions, there are no live hearings taking place in the civil courts. And we've been presented with a draft set of rules which, as I understand it, are being proposed on a medium to long term basis to regulate the position going forward. And our simple position on this is that it is premature to introduce a permanent set of rules where there is no evidence base to justify them. So we have suggested that a pilot scheme is introduced whereby proof hearings are held in the Court of Session and in Sheriff Courts to basically allow an analysis to take place about how those evidential hearings and proof hearings work, what the pros and cons of live hearings are, and that has to be done in a comparison with virtual hearings. And the pilot that we have proposed suggests that it takes place over the course of a year and then the issue is revisited. And that would allow some empirical data to be gathered from all court users, all stakeholders in the court system, about their experiences of live hearings. It's impossible to do that at the moment when there is a default position of no live hearings, and virtually nothing is taking place in court apart from the inner house and cases which are deemed to have a justifiable cause for a live hearing, but they are very much in the minority. Taking up the point about digital exclusion, this is one of the major concerns that the Law Society has. Whether the digital poverty or exclusion issues relate to an inability to afford the hardware or inability to use the software or simply a lack of tech know-how or poor internet connection, I think it's fair to say that the minority of court users face these difficulties, but it is a significant minority and it needs to be addressed. And our view is that there is no quick fix on this. So any system which is introduced has got to be flexible to take account of the difficulties that those that are in that category of digital poverty, excluded for whatever reason, from interacting with the court digitally, have a means of participating effectively.
Okay, thank you. Pam, then Richard, then Paul.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and thank you for obviously coming along to join our round table. It's been very helpful listening to the advantages and the disadvantages of going digital. My question is more around about the individual itself. Are they allowed to disagree to a default remote hearing? And that could be for many reasons. They don't understand what's happening. It could be for they need a translator. It could be for what Alexandra and Ian have talked about, the access to technologies, or any issues that may impede basically upon their ability that they feel uncomfortable to be remotely heard. So it's around that, the individual's rights.
Richard.
Thank you very much. Although I'm a great enthusiast for technology and I've devoted my whole career to thinking about it, and this might surprise people, I don't think you should be thinking in terms of these changes as short term. I've always advised that major change to a court system will take at least 10 years. People talk about court transformation projects over a couple of years. I find that entirely improbable. There's huge cultural and procedural and technical issues to be overcome. So I want to stress again, we're at the foothills. And although we've had to put emergency processes in place for COVID, once we emerge from COVID, I'm not of the view we immediately rush one way or another. And so the observation about piloting, I think, is very powerful. That is how most technological developments in most other industries proceed. You test, you experiment, you refine too quickly to come to a set of firm rules or processes without the evidence seems to me to be mistaken. And so I urge you again to think we're at the beginning of a process. Let's gather data, let's pilot and experiment rather than dive in with dogmatic views of the next generation. I want to say something about assisted, exclusion. And I think there's of course there's an issue about people who are not comfortable with technology. I think there are other issues of exclusion though that are probably even more worrying. One is about literacy, that even if you have a handheld machine and you use your technology daily, that doesn't mean you have the wherewithal to, if you're, for example, self-represented, to marshal your evidence and present your arguments. There's also an issue of confidence. There's also cultural issues about which sectors of society feel comfortable in the kind of combat that is involved in litigation and disputes. And also you should think that in the UK, around 19% of working adults have limiting long-term illness, impairment or disability, people for whom attendance at a physical courtroom is often very forbidding. Now, if you look at the research, for example, at the Oxford Internet Institute, where I am, into the level of take-up of internet usage, effectively, only about 5% of people in society don't have internet access. But the problem is not for me about whether or not you have connectivity or access, it's whether or not you have the confidence, if you're self-represented, to use these systems. But I say balancing these against also other forms of exclusion. This leads me again to the observation, surely we should have a mixed bag of facilities available. And depending on the particular court users and the nature of the case, some cases will be heard in person, some by video, some by audio, even by pop-up courts. I think some cases should be handled in the papers alone. We want a flexible approach, and we direct appropriate cases to appropriate forms of resolution in a way that is both proportionate and just. So let's not, as I say, jump to video hearings, put the procedures in place and think, dust our hands off and say that's digital technology in the courts done. Next project, please. We're at the beginning of a journey here.
Thank you. Paul, then Ruth.
Thank you, convener, and thank you to everyone for their contributions this morning. And I think what's coming across is a sense that this needs to be evidence-led and we need to take our time with this because necessity may be the mother of invention, but we want to actually take time, I think, to learn from the experience, certainly, of the past 18 months. I mean, I think I would just like to touch on kind of two points. I think on digital exclusion, I think I would agree with what's being said in terms of ensuring that people have the right support. And my concern would be often that we end up in a two-tier system, even within, you know, a digital offering. So sometimes people who don't have access to internet can't do the audiovisual and end up, participating via a phone. And that's not always, I think, the best option, particularly, I think, you know, as Karen alluded to, in terms of children's hearings and family courts, where often these issues are very emotive, can be very stressful, can be very challenging for people. And I think participation on a phone can often... It can be difficult to read people's tone. It can be difficult to get a sense of what support someone might need. And I think also if someone is having being supported by an advocate or by legal counsel, it can be often hard, you know, for that relationship in a digital setting to be well established and for the person to get the right support. So I think there are certainly things that need to be looked at in terms of ensuring that we have a parity of access, even within digital offerings. I think there's also something that Ruth touched on in terms of the public's access to the courts and how, where it's appropriate, can the public ensure that they can be present if that is their choice to do that. I mean, within our own public galleries here at Holyrood, they've been empty, obviously, for the duration of the pandemic. The difference, I suppose, being is that we would broadcast all of the public meetings of the Parliament via the website or indeed via Parliament TV. I suppose the difference is that we haven't you know, quite reached the levels where court proceedings are all, you know, digitally available or in live time available. So I suppose I'm keen to understand how we protect the right of the public to be present in court as well if we move to a digital setting. I mean, certainly council meetings, for example, I'm currently a serving councillor as well. I mean, we have a kind of strange process of if you want to join the meeting as a member of the public, you have to request to do that prior to it and be let into the kind of system that we use. Otherwise, you have to watch it after the live event on YouTube. So, again, these are sorts of issues I think we need to look at so that we protect that, you know, fundamental right people have to be present.
Thanks. And Ruth, an apologies, I didn't see you earlier.
Not at all. A number of points, if I may, and picking up on some of the discussion. Forgive me, I probably will resort to some anecdotes because it may give you a colour. First of all, I wholeheartedly agree that this committee requires a proper evidence base before it starts considering what innovations it wishes to consider going forward for digital technology in our courts. And in relation to that, Kay's already mentioned the consultation in relation to virtual hearings post-pandemic. And I would recommend to the committee that they take some time to read the responses, albeit those contain a number of anecdotes. There is some evidence base there because the responses are from solicitors, advocates, judges, but also people and representative bodies such as Citizens Advice Bureau and other voluntary organisations and some local authorities as well. Digital exclusion, yes, of course, that's incredibly important. I agree with Richard that it's not just a question of having the ability for the technology, and this is where the anecdotes come in. And picking up a point which Paul made as well, the support which an advocate or a solicitor can give to the client. We have been able to adapt to the courts using technology, but it is frankly very difficult to have two or three screens going at once. So you have one screen, forgive me for the anecdote, with the court in front of you and the boxes of the judge and your opponent. You have another screen with the documents, and then you have another screen where your client and your solicitor is trying to give you instructions as things take place. Now, I am too old for my brain to work in that way. I can't keep my eye on three different screens at the same time. So we do have to think about these things. I realise that's just a technical micro element, but it is something important to consider. And again, I would suggest it's not entirely satisfactory for a client to have to give instructions to his or her solicitor or counsel through tapping into a WhatsApp message. And also you miss the opportunity to discuss the case with them inside or outside of court as well beforehand. So that is important. And also when clients or witnesses are giving evidence with the digital exclusion, documents are put up on screen. They have to master that technology themselves. And often they're just with phones, smartphones, rather than a big screen. And that's very difficult. Now, I'd say these are technical problems. If the committee wishes to go down the digital route, those problems are very real and will have to be solved. There's also a question which Alexander raised about the resources. Who resources these matters? And he very kindly praised the legal profession for what it done over the last 20 months or so, and I'm grateful for that. I wouldn't be quite so grateful for the notion that the legal profession should pay for making everything digitally inclusive. Solicitors' firms, and indeed my own organisation, the faculty, we have spent a considerable amount of money over the last 20 months, not surprisingly, hardwiring our premises and making sure there's decent connectivity. But even then, I get, as Treasurer reports, day and daily of things breaking down. Indeed, I've been in court when the connections have broken down. So even chucking a huge amount of money costs, but equally that's us for our members. And we provide the legal service, we don't provide the technology, nor do we provide the courts. And it goes back to my two fundamentals about, and the second fundamental, access to the courts, which is a constitutional principle. And frankly, we as lawyers shouldn't be providing the courts. We are those who assist the users. And of course, as Lord Reid remarked, we are remunerated for that. and there was another comment of, yeah. And I would also agree with Richard. If you look at the consultation responses, they do make interesting reading, although lengthy reading. The faculty's response is very much to accept that we should learn from the last 20 months so far as digital technology is concerned. And in general terms, if I could summarise the faculty's response, it is a bit of the mixed bag. In general terms, we can see there's a very real place for procedural business, for example, being held virtually. But the default position for contentious or substantive business should be in person and in a courtroom. But we recognise there will be cases, either way, where parties want to flip it. And we propose a general test of the interests of justice, which the courts are well used to using. And this goes back to a point which Pam made. What about if the parties want an in-person hearing or indeed a digital hearing? We would be firmly of the view that that is a factor that the courts should attach weight to in considering whether to have a virtual hearing or an in-person hearing. And we don't think it should be simply down as it was presently proposed to matters of complexity or difficulty. We think, I mean, the parties, the users of the court service are clearly at the heart of it, and their views should be given weight to. Whether they're given overriding weight would be a question for the individual judge who's well used to weighing these things up. So, yes, it's acknowledged that the views are polarised. The faculty has tried to be, and hopefully will continue to be, constructive in its response. And recognises the failings of our system. Clearly there are failings, but there is a danger in just having going too quick, too fast. And that's why I would echo the comments which we've heard around this table that you do require a proper evidence base so that our court system in Scotland is fit for the 21st century and hopefully the 22nd and 23rd as well.
Maggie, then Kay.
Thanks, Joe. I like your optimism there, Ruth. If I can pick up on, and I wanted to ask, I realise this might be quite a broad issue around how the systems and processes that we have, and you mentioned in your remarks just then about judges being well used to determining whether certain courses of action should be taken or alternatives should be found. I'm interested. And this is anecdotal, but I was speaking to somebody who supports survivors of domestic abuse. And during the COVID emergency legislation, there's been domestic abuse trials have been virtual by default. But I understand that only about 10 have actually been virtual because usually the defence objects. And how do we get to a point where we balance in whose interests are those balances actually weighed? Because I think, I suppose that's a very, very small point in a much broader question around does our justice system get gender? Does it get racial and other diversity issues in a meaningful way? And how can we not plug those into the system, but how can we be mindful of those? How can we work with the Equalities Unit, with other organisations, to make sure that we aren't entrenching inequality? Because I think we look at the both pre-pandemic and during the system, there are certain entrenched impacts that potentially disproportionately affect women, disproportionately affect people of colour, disproportionately affect some of the more marginalised people, whether they are victims, complainers, or defendants, and I suppose I'm just interested in how we navigate that space, because at the moment I don't think our justice system gets gender, for instance, and I think we have an opportunity here to at least try to address that.
Okay, Kay. Then I've got Fulton, then Richard, then Karen. Let's go, Kay.
I'd like to touch on a few things, starting with you, Maggie. We do have the Judicial Institute, which is a renowned organisation for training the judiciary. They certainly get training on diversity, racial issues. So that's part and parcel of becoming a judge. You go through all that training. Also, if the Scottish Court Tribunal Service and the Scottish Civil Justice Council are going forward with any new initiatives, we do compile equality impact statements, and you'll see there's a very full one, particularly for this mode of attendance for hearings. The Scottish Civil Justice Council are going to update that in the light of the responses received. So we do take our equality duty very, very seriously. Digital poverty, absolutely key is flexibility, and that we do what we can, and we need to be better at it. We provide online resources, and that's okay if you can access them. We have written information. We are developing a suite of videos so that people can see what's required to attend an online hearing. Our court staff are always accessible to answer any questions. But yeah, hands up. I think we all need to be better at this. And I know that the Lord Justice Clerk has mentioned at one stage having digital Zoom booths in Singapore, where basically somebody can go into a court premises in a booth, use court technology to access a hearing. Should we be looking at that sort of initiative in our local libraries? So, and again, that then takes me on to resources, and I hear what Ruth said about that. And what I would say is that the Scottish Court Tribunal Service has been well supported by the Scottish Government during the pandemic. And we really do have strong digital foundations, which we did not have before, which means that we can continue with our hearings in the civil. You'll all be aware of the remote jury centres model for criminal business and for our tribunals. That's how we're managing to get business done. But obviously, we need to keep up to date with that resourcing. I know Ruth said it's not for the legal profession to pay for that, but I would challenge that. I would say the legal profession do have a duty. So, for example, I was attending remotely a judicial review hearing yesterday. There was two QCs who were giving evidence. Well, not giving. They were participating remotely. It was a remote hearing, and they were in the advocates' consulting rooms in the High Street, and the internet connection wasn't good enough. We had to postpone the hearing. They had to move into the advocates' library, which had a much better internet connection. And the lesson for that is, and I know advocates are aware of that, that work needs to be done. So how that's funded, that's not for me to say, but it is an issue for everybody, the resourcing going forward.
I wasn't suggesting that lawyers should not resource their own offices. What I would balk at is the idea that we should resource the courts, because that's not our job. And of course there are issues, but those issues with connectivity apply not just to advocates or solicitors, but they do apply to the individuals who use the courts as well. And who pays for them?
I absolutely agree with that, Ruth. And the other thing that we've come round to is who makes the decision as to whether it should be an in-person hearing or a remote hearing. Well, that is a judicial decision, and they do take into account all the circumstances, and they will take into account if a person cannot have access in some way to any digital connectivity. I know, for example, that the Inner House has had an in-person hearing because there was a party litigant who had no access, and that's our most senior court, when it's three judges. So there's the key for everything is flexibility. And that's a good thing about having rules rather than primary legislation, because rules can be changed quite easily in the light of experience, or it might be that we need new guidance or amendments to rules, and that's one of the advantages of doing putting rules and procedures in place that way. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll go to Fulton, then Richard, then Karen, then I think Karen, and then Pam. So Fulton.
thanks, Convener, and thanks to the panel for the information you've provided this morning. I think it's been really, really helpful. I mean, my question is quite a broad brush one, and it's something that actually, you know, everybody's already touched on. It seems to me that even when we're talking today, and you know, when I'm dealing with constituents on this issue, as I'm sure other members will have felt as well, that for some people the digital courts are working well, and for other people they aren't. And actually, probably the vulnerable witnesses that others have talked about are probably a really good example of that, where some vulnerable witnesses are benefiting really, really well from using digital technology. We can think of some examples, perhaps, where there's an abusive relationship and the witness doesn't need to meet the abuser. And then in other situations, there's perhaps vulnerable witnesses are actually being more excluded from the justice system because of the online and remote working. So I do wonder, how do we get better at identifying cases or individuals where remote hearings are going to be beneficial and allow more access to justice, and how do we identify those where it's not? I know this has been touched on, but I'm thinking, you know, is there any way, is there any work we can do there? Is there anything the committee can look at to try and help establish a framework, almost, if you like, about how we can identify that? Happy with any MD answer, yeah. Convener.
Thanks. To you. Okay, Richard.
Just to make a couple of observations about technology. Consider the technology I'm using, or we're all using today. This is the worst this technology is ever going to be from now on. Technologies are getting better and better. Indeed, our machines are becoming increasingly capable. Scarcely a day passes that you don't hear news of some kind of system technology, app breakthrough, startup, and so forth. I know people are often rather, I suppose, excluded from debate about the future of technology, but I say to you, we're living in a time of greater technological advance than humanity's ever witnessed. And what we're doing a little bit today, which I forewarned at the beginning, is falling into the trap of thinking this is a discussion about video hearings or physical hearings, not taking account of the reality that during this decade, we're going to see the emergence in a major way of artificial intelligence techniques being used in courts around the world. We're going to see the emergence of what I call asynchronous hearings. You're going to be seeing greater use of blockchain for recording hearings. Now, a lot of these notions, I suspect, will be rather foreign to you. I wanted, if it's not improper to suggest this, that I do this a lot in England. I'm more than happy to, in my own time, to provide briefings to MSPs and judges and officials on what technologies are coming over the horizon. Because you've got to be careful that you're not thinking about putting in place technologies, say by 2025, that would have been good in 2021. The technologies are advancing, and there's many more possibilities out there than video hearings. And in relation to all of this, I look at people's faces today a little bit, very friendly, but a little bit grim. It should actually be exciting. Goodness me, we face huge problems in our justice systems around the world. Surely we should be excited by the possibility that some of the problems we face, if with sufficient ingenuity, imagination, innovation, investment, some of these problems might be overcome by the technologies that are overcoming problems in medicine, that are overcoming problems in health, that are over in education, that are overcoming problems in all aspects of society. So we shouldn't be looking at this as a problem, oh, here's the various things it can do. I maintain this is a long-term process we're involved with, but you have to take a long-term view of the developing technologies, and I would like you to have the confidence to look at this with energy and enthusiasm and excitement, rather than thinking, oh, what are the limitations here, and this is all doom and gloom. In my 40 years of working in legal technology, I've never been more excited, because the technologies are now emerging to help us solve some fairly significant justice problems that we've had for years. And so, in summary, the technology is not standing still, and we should embrace this rather than resist this.
That was a wee joke for us all, Richard, but I think it's main, if our faces are all looking a bit gloomy, it's maybe because the weather was a bit cold as we came in this morning. I'm going to go to Karen, then Palm, if that's...
Thank you, Convener. Really following on from what Maggie was discussing, but maybe getting a bit more specific here, but effective communication underlies the entire legal process. How will you factor in opportunities to identify impairments and make adjustments for disabilities? Thinking of the deaf community, for example, and Kay mentioned Equalities duties. Will this lens be used for the evidence and in any consultation analysis for any advancements? Thank you.
Karen?
My apologies. Karen, could you repeat the last part of that?
It was just asking, will the lens, the Equalities lens, be used for the evidence that's being gathered, and will it be used in any consultation analysis for any advancements?
I mean, I would certainly, it's obviously the consultation that's ongoing at the moment. You would hope that matters of equality, looking at people's disabilities and so on, would be looked at. I mean, I'm very conscious, on a personal level, my own father's deaf, and I'm aware of the many, many difficulties that he has dealt with during the COVID pandemic, mask wearing, not least of it. But I'm conscious that when I think of what we're doing at the moment, that many of the technologies that are available to us, he would struggle with much of that. And it is something, obviously, that needs to be addressed. And I'm sure the consultation process that's ongoing at the moment will have to look at all of that. And as others have said, for some who have disabilities, physically going to a courtroom is a difficulty for them. And actually, for those people, the online hearings perhaps work better. So, yes, I would imagine that that would be something that absolutely needs to be looked at when we look about how, when we consider how we're going to take this forward and how things will be in the future.
Thanks. And Pam, and then Ian.
Thank you, Convener. I share Richard's enthusiasm about technology evolving and that this is the worst we'll have technology as. Now, that's what we've talked about today, technology, and we've talked about the advantages and disadvantages of going remotely. But what about the access? Because we know today, when we go on meetings on Zoom or anything we do, access falls. It could be Wi-Fi connection, it could be everything. So what about the connections and where would the onus lie here? Because if somebody did not turn up to court, there would be penalties and there would be obviously, you know, wasting court time, or it could be obviously a valid reason. But what would happen if they can't connect, and what kind of reasons or what kind of test would we apply to that? And this question is for probably Kay as well, obviously looking at the 5-year digital strategy, but also with Richard, his enthusiasm talking about technology evolving. What about the connection?
Well, Ian, first.
Just taking up that point, I mean, I had practical experience of running a proof hearing where we had a witness giving evidence from Morocco, and it was a serious case where credibility issues were very much at stake, and her internet connection simply didn't work. And within 30 minutes of the proof starting, which was scheduled to last 3 days with senior and junior counsel, the sheriff had to abandon the case and basically refix the proof hearing for much later in the year. So that is a practical issue, and there is no easy answer to that in the sense that, you know, the witness was giving evidence from abroad. She couldn't travel back to Scotland to give her evidence in person, and there was really no option but to adjourn. So without better internet connectivity, that is a practical issue that could arise at any stage in a case. I've also had a situation where a sheriff principal presiding over the court at home had a very, very poor internet connection, had to adjourn the case. Now, I think these issues are being addressed, and I suspect that that will not be the norm going forward. But you know, they do arise, and the court just has to be flexible in taking these matters into account. Taking Fulton's point up in terms of those who have difficulty with interacting, I mean, there's two categories. There's vulnerable witnesses, which I think it's been touched on before, and you know, the Vulnerable Witnesses Scotland Act, part two of that deals with measures that can be put in place in civil proceedings, and it's really a question of flagging up to the court whether someone would be deemed to be a vulnerable witness, and then things like the use of live television links or use of screens or the use of a supporter, or indeed taking evidence by commission. These are measures that can be put in place to assist that particular witness to give their evidence in the most appropriate manner. But there's the other category who are not necessarily vulnerable witnesses, but they simply have the difficulty of interacting with the court system on a digital platform. And again, these are issues that really need to be flagged up. There needs to be a sort of formalised process put in place to flag up and highlight these difficulties well in advance, so that the court is aware of any potential issues that are going to arise and can take appropriate measures. So, you know, these are discussions that would normally be held at procedural hearings, and if necessary, the court can take cognizance of that and say, right, well, it's not appropriate for that particular person to have to interact with the court digitally, and they should be allowed to appear in person. whether it's procedural business or whether it's evidential hearings. So it's just a question of making sure that the court is structured in a way that it's flexible to take into account all of these different possibilities.
Thanks. Kay?
I would agree with what Ian's said there. What would normally happen is there would be a discussion at normally a procedural hearing or a hearing in advance of the substantive hearing. And it's really for the judge to decide what is appropriate in the interests of justice. And the judge in that circumstance will take into account the nature of the case, the public interest, and the ability of the parties to effectively participate in the proceedings. So that's how that is taken into account. I'd like to go back to the effective communication point that Karen mentioned and Karen addressed. I would just give a reassurance that, particularly we're looking at the remote the attendance at remote hearings, the Scottish Civil Justice Council did compile an equalities impact statement. It's a very full document. They will be updating that before it comes back to the Council. And just to be aware as well, they're also preparing a business and regulatory impact assessment as well. So they both go hand in hand. These are documents that need to be compiled, and the Council will need to look at those when they're deciding what appropriate rules should be put in place. And for access, where does the onus lie on how people can get access? Well, one thing that is inherent in the system is that there are practice sessions. So before any hearing is taking place, the clerk of court will make sure that all the participants are in a practice session. And hopefully at that point, some of the connectivity issues will arise. And that's certainly what happened in the judicial review I observed yesterday. There was quite a few practice sessions and then the decision was taken, right, we're going to have to do something differently here. And it did proceed as was necessary. But if it hadn't been for the practice sessions, those issues would not have been resolved.
OK, thanks. We've got Karen and then Richard.
A few points just to mention. One of them being, going back to what Richard was saying about these are exciting times, and I think there's no doubt about that. I think it would be very interesting to see how the technology develops, how we will be working in the next 5 to 10 years. What is somewhat discouraging, to go back to just to mention the telephone hearings, is we already have a slightly better forum, the WebEx hearing, but telephone hearings continue to be used. I feel very strongly, and certainly some of the members who have contacted me with their views feel very strongly that these just simply practically don't work. If you've ever been on a court hearing that takes place by telephone, you can't tell if you lose a party during the call until perhaps someone addresses them. It could be very difficult to kind of keep track of what's going on. You can't see, you can't read people's emotions, how they are reacting, whether they are bored or interested in what you have to say. There's all sorts of issues around that, and I think really we need to be moving away from that and using the technology that's available to us. And just quickly on the open justice point, it might be stretching it somewhat to consider myself a young lawyer. I'm probably somewhat past that now. But my years of training are close enough in my own mind. And open justice is very important for members of the public, but also for those of us that are learning to be lawyers, learning to be solicitors, learning to be advocates. I know that I personally learned a tremendous amount being sent down to court for the most basic hearing. But you got to listen to and watch your more experienced peers addressing the sheriff, or indeed sitting in a court of session action addressing a judge on matters. And I raise that only as a very minor point. It's just something to take account of when looking at how we will deal with matters going forward. It's helpful for the more junior members of the profession to see hearings being dealt with. It's a forum in which I have learned, and given that younger members of either the bar or younger solicitors are not currently able to watch hearings in process, that is it's something that's difficult for them. And there are certainly learning opportunities in just sitting in the courts. And also just attending the courts, there is, I would say, a collegiate approach, no doubt, in the bar and certainly in the local faculties, where you have the opportunity to mix with other lawyers, to perhaps approach more experienced lawyers to discuss a case and just to get to know older members of the bar. And again, as the technology develops, there may be ways to address some of that. And these are just minor points, but something to consider when we look at what we'll be doing going forward.
Okay, thanks. Ruth, and then we'll go to Richard as our final contribution. Ruth.
Just a couple of matters which we haven't really touched on, but I think they are nonetheless important in this general category of access to justice, which I mentioned at the start of the session. The first is witnesses rather than parties to the proceedings. And it seems to me, and my experience is, that taking evidence from witnesses virtually is suboptimal at best. It's very difficult to know if they are on the right page, for example. It's very difficult to make sure that they are alone, they're not being tutored, and of course they're given all the whys and wherefores beforehand and the rules, but those seems to me something we have to consider. And there's also the empirical evidence lacking as to whether or not it is more effective and efficient in terms of getting to the truth to have evidence given virtually or in person. I am aware that some research has been done, but it may be of an anecdotal nature rather than empirical nature, of expert witnesses, for example, who down south, who've indicated that, and this must be anecdotal, have indicated that they felt they had an easy time of it. Now, some people might think that's a good idea rather than having a hard time, but it goes back to the general solemnity of the whole proceedings. So I think you'd have to look at the experience of witnesses. And the other matter I'd wish to pick up on, final matter, and it reflects what Karen was saying earlier. Training, yes, absolutely, incredibly important. We do exercise collegiality in the bar. We consider that at the root of what we do. We learn by seeing and by doing. And I mentioned the consultation responses earlier. Our junior members, those who are 5 years and under who called, have a very powerful response in relation to their experiences and what they think about virtual hearings. But there's another aspect which I think you might also wish to consider, having regard to this idea of going forward into the future and technology is going to evolve, which of course it will, and we'll be able to innovate. And this goes also segs into the resources issue. It may well be that only the well-resourced firms who deal with white-collar type work are able to afford that. And I do wonder if we just end up having big city firms able to provide legal services, whereas we know Scotland is crying out for the rural solicitors to continue in practice, and they're under increasing pressures. And if we're going to advance in this way, I think you also have to consider the future of the solicitor side of the profession, because it may be that the big law firms see a business opportunity there to the exclusion of the smaller, more locally based law firms. And you may have those who don't live in the big cities having to travel in or dial in to see their solicitors, and that may not be satisfactory.
Okay, thank you very much. Time is tight, so I think our final contribution will be from Richard. I wonder, Richard, we've come at this at a time when we're hoping to be able to actually influence what happens going forward rather than just be a spectator in what's happening. So I wonder if you could touch in your final contribution on what it would mean to have, for instance, asynchronous hearings and what that would mean in practice. But I know your final
you
word.
So much, and thank you again for involving me. I'll lead into this by the question of connectivity. Of course, it's been a very practical issue. If broadband isn't sufficient and connections fall, the whole process has been very difficult indeed. This is an example, though, of the connectivity is the worst it's ever going to be today from now on. And it's not just for law, it's for health, education, and right across Scottish society, you will find that broadband will increase. So I think by 2024, for example, you wouldn't be having the discussion in light of 5G technologies and so forth that we're having today about poor connectivity. But the way we sidestep the issue of connectivity in any event, this takes me to the point, in the Civil Justice Council group that I chaired, was that we came up with the idea of asynchronous hearings. Communication synchronous, where people need to be available at the same time to communicate, a phone call, a meeting, and so forth. Asynchronous communication is where you don't need to be available, an email, a text message, a WhatsApp. You send a message and receive a message at your own convenience. Current court hearings are synchronous. Everyone has to be available, whether it's virtual or in a courtroom, you have to be available at the same time. The idea of the asynchronous hearings, which we advocated for low-value civil cases, is that the evidence and arguments are submitted electronically by the parties. There's some kind of online discussion, almost like an exchange of emails, moderated by the judge. And the judge then comes to his or her conclusion and determination in like form. There is no oral evidence. There is no physical hearing. There's no virtual hearings. There's no question of connectivity. There's no question of taking a day off work. Here we thought it would be a proportionate way of resolving very straightforward disputes. Every year on eBay, there are 60 million disputes amongst traders, 60 million. Almost none of them are sorted out by lawyers and courts. They're sorted out by asynchronous process. And I'm not saying this is the answer to all disputes, I really haven't, but I want to put this on the table as another possibility, an illustration of something that, for example, avoids the connectivity difficulties. And that proposition that we put forward was endorsed then by our Lord Chief Justice, by our Lord Chancellor. It's now part of government policy down here. As I stress, it's not the last word. It's just another possibility in this buffet we have of options in improving our system. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thanks very much. I think that is a good place for us to finish there. That's been a really useful session. Clearly, we're wanting to influence how this moves forward as a committee. So you've certainly given us lots to think about going forward. So thanks very much. We'll now move into private session.